have the right person in custody after a holiday market attack in Berlin left 12 people dead. One source telling CNN the fear now the attacker is still on the loose. They're armed and dangerous, and there could be more than one suspect. With me now to talk about this and more is Paul Cruickshank, CNN's terrorism analyst. Sejan Goel, he's a terrorism expert and an international security director at the Asia Pacific Foundation. And Soner Çaktay, he's the director of the Turkish Research Program at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy. Welcome to all of you. So Paul, German officials now believe they have the wrong person in custody. How difficult will it be for them now to track down a suspect?
Well, they have to start from scratch again if they indeed have the wrong person in custody, that they don't have the perpetrator of this attack in custody. They're going to have to follow a lot of leads. They are furiously examining the CCTV. They want the public to send in any kind of video that they might have filmed during the period of the attack for any clues for who perpetrated this. But clearly, this would return them back to square one. There are two German intelligence officials telling CNN that they now think it's unlikely they have the perpetrator of this attack in custody. And the German federal prosecutor on the record in the presser just a little while ago saying that we possibly need to assume that we arrested the wrong one. That perhaps is code for not a lot of confidence that they've got the right individual. And that may mean there's no link at all to an individual from Pakistan or this sort of refugee nexus. That may be incorrect in terms of the person behind this attack, Carol.
So say, John, there's a lot of right-wing populist politicians across the globe saying that a refugee from the Middle East was responsible for this. Is it a rush to judgment?
Well, certainly, if we look at the incidents that have taken place in Germany this year, there have been a number of plots, some small-scale attackers that were accepted into Germany, some actually used for fraudulent identity cards to get in, and then they carried out attacks on behalf of ISIS. They were not necessarily directed by the group, but they were inspired by them. So Germany has this track record, and there's already a lot of social tensions in the country. It's being exasperated by nationalist extremist sentiments inside Germany itself. And it's important to be cautious about what has transpired in the Berlin attack. Certainly, if we look at the recent events, there are connections, perhaps similarities to events with a nexus with ISIS. Only last week, a 12-year-old boy was arrested in Ludwigshafen in Germany, and he was groomed online by ISIS, and his intention was to attack a marketplace. So there are connections in that sense, but there is no direct linkage as yet, and we need to wait and see for the German authorities to fully establish a picture.
In speaking about direct linkages, there are some linking these terror attacks in Turkey and in Switzerland and in Berlin, Germany. But in Switzerland, a mosque was attacked, and of course, in Turkey, a Russian ambassador was attacked. And maybe you can help us out with this, Soner, because we're confused about what the motive was, because the perpetrator yelled out, Allah Akbar, but he also says this is from Aleppo. So what do you make of that?
Clearly, this is a more of a Syrian civil war-related attack. I think that Turkey is now unfortunately seeing the fallout of the war in Syria, which is next door, and its involvement in that war. We saw in the past week attacks by a Kurdish group, PKK, in Turkey, including twin terror suicide bomb attacks in front of a soccer stadium that killed dozens of people. This was by a Turkish-Kurdish group, but the way I see it is it was retaliatory against Turkey's recent gains against Syrian Kurds, which are allied with the PKK. And now we're seeing yet one more fallout effect of the Syrian war. The assassination, unfortunate assassination of the Russian ambassador was, of course, a politically charged murder. The assassin said that this was in protest of Russia's involvement in Syria, which is against Turkey's policy there. The two countries are actually in a proxy war. So this is, to me, a sign that countries, when they get involved in civil wars next door, ultimately that war comes to bite the hand that feeds it. And Turkey's unfortunately now going through that crisis.
So Paul, President-elect Trump said that Islamic jihadist terrorism was to blame on the attack of this Russian ambassador. So in light of what Soner just told us, is that fair to say?
There's no evidence so far. There's no claim of responsibility from any Islamist terrorist group like ISIS or Al-Qaeda or other jihadi groups. It could well be that they shouted Allahu Akbar just because they were a little bit religious. That's a phrase which is sort of often used as an exclamation in somewhere like Turkey. We just really don't yet have reliable information, credible information on what the motivation was behind this attack, beyond the fact that there was a clear grievance against the Russians for the brutal campaign that's going on in Aleppo. That much was clear, that this was retribution for that, coming at a time when there's really growing concern that Russia is stoking the fires of global jihad through this this sort of brutal air operation over Aleppo in cohorts with the Syrian regime, that this is really playing to Al-Qaeda, to ISIS in their recruiting efforts, in their messaging to try to depict this as a struggle between a global conspiracy against Islam and the people fighting back.
So say, John, Clarissa Ward just reported, though, that Vladimir Putin, the foreign minister sort of embraced Trump's comments and is looking forward to working with the United States on a solution in Syria. But Iran is also involved with Russia when it comes to Syria. So how would that work?
Well, that complicated significantly, and keep in mind that the way Assad was able to take control of Aleppo was with the assistance of Shia militia groups like Hezbollah, other entities from Iraq, from Iran, and even as far as Afghanistan. And we know that future Trump administration has shown some caution and skepticism about the nuclear deal with the Obama administration. And Iran, in turn, has also developed close relations with Russia. So it's a very complicated situation. I guess that's a microcosm of the mess that is Syria and the ramifications that it has regionally and the knock-on effects that it has globally. This is something that will need to be clarified, because the longer the mess exists in Syria, the longer the tensions, the fallout, the violence exists, we will have these shards shooting off in different locations, and it results in terrorism, and unfortunately it impacts on us directly in the West as well.
So Soner, just continuing on with this Iran conundrum, right? So why would Turkey be on Iran's side and Russia's side when it comes to Syria?
Turkey is not really on Iran's side, but I would say that Turkey and Russia have recently reached a convergence, not including Iran, and perhaps Iran is one country that wants to undermine this convergence. And the convergence is that in the absence of U.S. to provide leadership to the rebels, Turkey has now stepped in. In my view, it has become the voice of reason in northern Syria. It has negotiated with the Russians for the evacuation of the civilians, tens of thousands of people from eastern Aleppo. That process was going on, and in my view, the attack maybe aims to undermine Turkish-Russian convergence, because if Turkish-Russian relations now collapsed, the deal would fall apart and there would be no evacuation of civilians. And what would happen? You would see even more killing of the city's civilians as well as its Sunni Muslim inhabitants. What does that suggest for the jihadists? Sick as it sounds, I think that the jihadists actually like to see suffering and killing of Sunni Muslims continue, because Al-Qaeda and other groups and ISIS, they see themselves as avengers of Sunni Islam, and they're there to defend them, and they need to see suffering so they can go in and recruit. So perhaps they are the groups that want to undermine Turkish-Russian rapprochement, but I think that Russia will probably not overreact. It has a lot of what it wants in Syria from Turkey, including Turkish green light to the fall of Aleppo. So my sense is that the Russian leadership will not overreact to the assassination if Turkey runs a thorough investigation of the assassination, and that also seems to be happening. Typically, countries don't invite foreign intelligence agencies for investigations as such. Turkey has just invited Russian security officials so they can do a joint Turkish-Russian investigation of the assassination, which shows that Ankara is signaling to Moscow that it's taking this very seriously.
I think what this conversation has demonstrated is incredibly complicated. Thanks to all of you for making it clear, though. Paul Cruickshank, Sejan Goel, and Soner Çağatay. Still to come in the newsroom, a day after Moscow's ambassador is gunned down in Turkey, Russia and Turkey come face to face, and they say they finally have a plan to bring an end to the crisis in Aleppo.